A very good morning, dear friends. Hope you all are doing good. Kindly make sure you join in for the session. Today we'll be discussing a lot of important question papers. Please make sure you join in through the live chat on your mobile or laptops, because I'm connected through my phone, so I can see your live chats. Right, so a brief introduction about myself before I begin. Myself, Cyril Jacob. I hold a bachelor's in law from Kerala University. That's my BA LLB. I went on to pursue my master's from England. I hold a diploma in cyber law from Asian School of Cyber Laws, and I'm also an MBA graduate. I'm an independent practicing lawyer, apart from being a internationally published author. So these are my qualifications. I have many articles published on journals of international repute. So I have a few years of teaching experience, and especially some of my students have even cracked the NET exam. So please make sure you subscribe to Unacademy Plus using my code CYRILLIVE, Cyril Live. Okay, CYRILLIVE. If you use my code, you'll get a cool 10% off on your Plus subscription. These are the plans, dear friends. Okay, I recommend you to take the 6 month or the 12 month plan. For the 6 month plan, it is 1400 per month. So if you subscribe for that, you'll get a 10% off. If any of this plan, you'll get a 10% off. If you're having a long-term plan for the NET exam, then use my code for subscribing for the two-year plan. That comes at a monthly cost of 700 rupees. Okay. So Cyril Live is my code. So currently I am teaching the complete course on law. Okay, I'm taking the entire course on law. My classes are mainly in English. It is for all NTA UGC NET aspirants. Mainly for paper 2 law. All right. So currently I'm teaching unit 2, but you can still view anytime, anywhere the content of unit 1 also. I just completed jurisprudence, but I'm currently teaching constitutional and administrative law. Please join in immediately so you can be part of the live interactive sessions. So there are a plethora of benefits of subscribing to Unacademy Plus. You will have live structured courses, okay, by top educators. You have interactive sessions where you can be Having a personal attention will be garnered through these sessions with the educator like me. Doubt clearing sessions every fourth class is a doubt clearing session. You have unlimited access to content that is all educators' content. Okay, you can download the PDFs. Moreover, you have weekly quizzes. Then you have mega quizzes, which are 1 hour quizzes at the end of every course end. You can watch content anywhere, anytime through your mobile or laptop. That is the main benefit of subscribing to Plus. You can get unlimited access and more interactive session and structured courses, okay, which will help you to crack the NET exam. So let's crack it together. Okay, don't forget to use my code to subscribe. Today we'll be discussing a mixed bag of questions. From recent years or previous years, right? The subject is law. Myself, Cyril Jacob, your educator. Once again, a gentle reminder to use my code to subscribe. Cyril Live, that is C-Y-R-I-L, Live, L-I-V-E. Okay, let's move on. So the first question, in which of the following cases the International Court of Justice, which is also called the ICJ, pointed out that when in regard to any matter of practice, two states follow it repeatedly for a long time, it becomes a binding customary rule. Okay, this is about something like customs and international law. So here the ICJ is involved, and you need to point out in which particular case where it was said that if two states follow it for a long time, any particular practice or subject matter, it becomes a binding customary rule. In which case the court held that. So you should know that first. ICJ is located in Hague in Netherlands. It is an organ of the United Nations. You should be able to know the basics of the ICJ. Now, was it option A, West Rand Central Gold Mining Company case, limited? Okay. Or was it the South West Africa case? Is it C, right of passage over Indian territory case, that is Portugal versus India? Or option D, North Sea Continental Shelf case? As you can see, the right answer for this particular question is option C, right of passage over Indian territory case. So it was in this case where the International Court of Justice pointed out clearly that pertaining to any matter or practice on an international level, when two states follow a particular aspect or factor for a long time. Okay, custom, it is important to understand the essentials of a custom. You need to know the valid essentials of custom. Something that is followed for a long time and it is binding. Okay, then it becomes okay, right of passage over Indian territory case. Any doubts, dear friends? Okay. Now, the second question, moving on to the second question. So, we dealt with the first question, now second question. J.G. Stark. Now, Stark he was a notable jurist. Okay. And he is associated with which of the following? That is his writings. You have to know what are his writings. So was Stark associated with A, an introduction to international law? B, digest of international law? C, the changing structure of international law? Or D, the basis of obligation in international law? So in this case, as you can see, what is highlighted is the right answer. It is option A, an introduction to international law. That is what J.G. Stark, the notable jurist, is associated with. It is not digest of international law, or changing structure of international law, or basic obligation in international law. Right answer associated with J.G. Stark is an introduction to international law. All right. Now, pertaining to the third question, you need to be familiar with the Consumer Protection Act. Which year was it enacted in? 1986. You need to be familiar with the Consumer Protection Act to answer this question. So, which of the following is not correct? Most of the time, students tend to skip this word, not. We directly, since we are, we get a little bit tensed, we tend to read the questions too quickly and miss out keywords. Okay, that should not be done. So, which of the following is not true? That is incorrect in relation to the Consumer Protection Act. Option A, it extends to the whole of India except the state of Jammu and Kashmir. This is true. This statement is true. Okay, not false. It shall come into force on such date as the central government may by notification. Yes, the central government by notification should notify it in the official Indian Gazette. So this is also true. This act shall be in addition to and not in derogation of provisions of any other law. That is, it should be consistent with other laws and not inconsistent. This is also a true option. Then, the act shall override, that is, it shall completely violate the provisions of the Sale of Goods Act. This is a false and incorrect statement. Okay, this is a wrong or misleading statement. Hence, the option will not be A, B or C, but it will rather be option D. Okay. Moving on. Considering the fourth question. Which of the following cases the Supreme Court made it explicit, that is, it expressed that even when the authority has statutory power to take action without hearing, it would be arbitrary to take action without hearing and thus violative of Article 14 of the Indian Constitution. So regarding this particular question, which case is associated with this particular hearing or ruling? Is it option A, Kripak versus Union of India? By the way, Kripak versus Union was a, these all are very, very prominent cases or important cases. pertaining to the Indian Constitution. So is it AK Kripik versus Union of India, or option B, Union of India versus Satish Chandra, option C, AK Roy versus State of Punjab, or option D, HL Trehan versus Union of India? So the Supreme Court made an explicit judgment that even when the authority has statutory power to take action without hearing, it would be arbitrary to take action without hearing such a matter, and thus it will be violative of Article 14 of the Indian Constitution. So it was in HL Trehan versus Union of India where such a matter was considered. Okay. Now option 5, sorry, question 5, sorry. So law is not only a set of rules, but is a method or technique for harmonizing conflicting interests. So who made this statement? Who made this statement? You should be familiar with a lot of definitions. You should be familiar with a lot of statements. And this question is related to Unit 1 in your syllabus, jurisprudence. It is jurisprudential concept. So it was Roscoe Pound that clearly mentioned that law is not only a set of rules, but is a method or technique for harmonizing conflicting interests. So it was given by Roscoe Pound. As you can see, it's highlighted here, and it is not Auguste Comte, Herbert Spencer, or Leon Digweed. I would like to mention that kindly make sure you're familiar with their names. They are jurists, they are eminent jurists. Okay. Any doubts, dear friends? Moving on. There is a statement here, directors are agents of the company. In which of the following cases was the above principle laid down? Answer using the code given below. Was it Ferguson versus Wilson, Elkington and Company versus Harter, Hampshire Land Company, or Allen versus Hyatt? So here there is a list of codes. Codes must be observed carefully. Okay, so the codes are option A and B, option A, B and C, or all of the above. So directors, as you know, they are agents. What are agents? They are representatives of the principal. So there is a principal, an agent who is subordinated to the principal, and a person who is again further subordinate to the agent is sub-agent. So when it comes to a company, you have to understand the company law, where directors also act as representatives. So directors are representatives of a firm. So in all of the following cases, Ferguson versus Wilson, Elkington case, Hampshire Land Company case, Allen versus Hyatt, in all of these cases, so all of the above, it was held that principle was laid down that directors are agents of the company. So the code to be ticked is not 1, 2 or 3, rather it is option 4, that is D, all of the above. So we dealt with a few questions. Hope you're getting it clear. Now the next question. To answer this question, you need to be familiar with the concept of asylum and the types of asylum. Types or kinds of asylum. Okay. And which of the following statement is or are not correct? So which is basically incorrect? Which of these following statements? There is again, you have to use codes. Okay. And the first option is A, United Nations Declaration on Territorial Asylum was unanimously, that means majority, by way of majority, adopted in 1977 by the General Assembly. Now the question is, which of the following statement or statements, it can be more than one also because there is a code. So option B, let us move on. Article 14 of the 1943 UDHR, Universal Declaration of Human Rights, makes obligatory by states to grant asylum. Then option C, the International Code of Justice, that is the ICJ, explain the distinction between territorial asylum and diplomatic asylum in the Colombia versus Peru case. Option D, the Convention on the Status of Refugees, 1951, entered into force on April 22nd, 1954. So which of the following is incorrect? The options are only A is not correct, A and D is not correct, A, B, C and D is not correct, or all of the above are not correct. The answer is none of these statements are true. All statements are false. So A, B, C and D are wrong. So option 4, you should take it. All of the above are not correct in this particular. Is it clear, dear friends? Going on. Question number 8. Now you need to focus on legal reasoning questions too, because this forms a huge chunk of marks. So you will get types like assertion and reasoning. That is, one statement will be pertaining to a fact and the reason given. You should be able to understand whether that particular statement is significant or is it not insignificant, and the reasoning provided is justifiable or there is no logic, though no connection. You should be able to understand that. For solving legal reasoning, dear friends, you need to be familiar with the concept. You need to be familiar with the various principles. Without that, you cannot be able to answer legal reasoning. So it is important that you do not skip any part of any syllabus, okay, of any part of any subtopic also, because legal reasoning can erupt from any particular chapter, unit. So it is important to understand that, okay. So the assertioning here is provided. A state made law on any matter of concurrent list. As you know, there are three lists, dear friends. State list, union list, and concurrent list. So the assertion here is, on any matter of concurrent list prevails, notwithstanding any repugnancy with an earlier law made by the parliament. That is the assertion. So the reasoning provided for this first statement is that the parliament can make a law on any matter in the concurrent list that prevails in the concurrent list, that prevails over any repugnant state law. So both statements are true. A and R, assertioning and reasoning, are true, and R is the correct explanation. So reasoning is proper. Okay, so it is option A and not the remaining. Moving on. Question number 9. Which of the following is true relating to nuisance? So, for understanding nuisance, you should be familiar with the law of torts. You should be familiar with negligence, nuisance. So many questions come from there. Option A, an action for nuisance is actionable per se. Per se means as it is, and no special damage need to be proved. Remember, the statement should be true. So this is not true. Okay, then it can be committed through the medium of intangible objects, which is true with regard to nuisance, because nuisance can be conducted or committed through the medium of intangible objects. Okay, the remaining options, it is direct interference with the possession of the plaintiff, and there is no interference with plaintiff's use or enjoyment of land. The most suitable option, you should always consider the most suitable option, and this is the most suitable. Question 9, the option B will be the right answer. Then question number 10. You have family law, and to be able to answer this regarding divorce, you should be, this is a Muslim personal laws, okay, because all these cases cited here are Muslim personal laws. So in which of the following case, which is the case that where the court held that divorce is good in law though bad in theology, that is pertaining to a religious text or perspective, divorce is a bad concept. However, in the case of law, it is a good matter. It is in the case of Sarabhai case. Okay, the remaining cases, you should be familiar with the Muslim law. You should know these cases. Kindly refer to these cases. They are important. Okay, it is in the Sarabhai case that the court held that divorce is good in law though bad in theology. From a theological perspective, it's bad, but divorce is good in law. Hope it's clear. Now question number 11. Advisory opinion can be given by the International Court of Justice on legal question. On whose request? Is it option A, on the request of the Security Council, on the request of the General Assembly, on the request of General Assembly or Security Council, both, on the request of Economic and Social Council, if authorized by the Economic and Social Council, is the ECOSOC. And please be familiar with the six principal organs of UN. Okay. You have General Assembly, Security Council, Trusteeship Council, which is no longer in existence. Then Economic and Social Council. Then you have International Court of Justice for settling disputes. So many councils are there. Six organs of UN you should be familiar with. So advisory opinion can be given by the International Court of Justice on the request of the General Assembly and the Security Council. Both these two. Okay, so option C is the right answer. Question 12. The Supreme Court in which case observed the issue of pollution should not be resolved at the cost of the poor people's livelihood? It was in the MC Mehta case, because he was a activist. He was known for his activism, MC Mehta. This is related to environmental law. Moving on. 13th question. Who of the following has viewed that there is a legal duty on the part of the existing state to recognize any community that has in fact acquired the characteristics of statehood? So you should be familiar with international law to answer this question. Okay. Especially public international law. It is Lothar Pact. Okay. Lothar Pact. It is about views, perspectives of individuals. Then question 14. Which of the following jurists deny legal character of international law? It is the jurist Pufendorf that denied legality for international law. Okay, it was not Hobbes, Oppenheim or Stark. It is option B, Pufendorf. Of the following cases, the following quote is taken. Principles of natural justice must be read in provisions to the law. Is it State of UP versus Vijay Kumar Tripathi? Yes, it is State of UP versus Vijay Kumar Tripathi and not the ITC versus State of Madras or Manjula Manjeri Devi case Satyanarayan. It is the first option, option A. Then 16th question. Which of the following does not constitute sedition? So you should be familiar with offenses against state. Law of Crimes Unit. Is it of the does not? Please remember the question keywords does not. That A, disappropriation of the government, excite disrespect against government, commenting on administrative actions of the government, or attempting to excite disaffection against the government. It is option C. If you comment on administrative actions of the government, it won't amount to sedition. It is not sedition. So option C. Now you need to know the schools of jurisprudence to answer this question. So which of the following jurists is not, kindly remember this word, not related to historical school? Is it Savigny, Ulrich, Henry Maine? It is, there is one E here, or Hegel. It is option B, who is not associated with historical school. Is it clear difference? Any doubts? Kindly let me know. I'm following through the live chat on my mobile phone. So, 18th question. A marriage solemnized between two Hindus who are Sapinda. So you should know Hindu, you should be familiar with Hindu Marriage Act. Okay. Who are Sapindas of each other shall be, is it option A, valid if the custom or usage governing any of them permits a marriage between the two? Option B, valid if the custom or usage governing each of them permits a marriage between the two? Or option C, voidable if the custom or usage governing each of them permits a marriage between the two. The final option is void. C is voidable. D is void if the custom or usage governing each of them permits a marriage between the two. So the right option will be B, valid if the customer usage governing each of them permits a marriage between the two. Is it clear? Which of the following cases doctrine of frustration was laid down? Is it BOI, that is Bank of India? Finance Limited custodian case? Orissa Textile Mills Limited versus Ganesha Das case? Okay. Sachidananda Patnaik versus GP and Company case, or Taylor versus Caldwell? Kindly note the doctrine of frustration was laid down in the Taylor versus Caldwell. So, doctrine of frustration is also commonly, you should know, law of contracts. It's an English case law. Moving on to the 20th question. In which case the principle of ubi just ibi remedium? Kindly be familiar with Latin maxims. Okay. In which case was the principle of ubi just ibi remedium was recognized? It is Ashby versus White. All right. Which of the following statements is correct? Option A, a person who wrongfully rescinds a contract is entitled to compensation for any damage which he has sustained through the non-fulfillment of the contract. Dear friends, sometimes the questions are not the problem, it is the options that create a confusion. So make sure you take time, say a couple of readings over and over of the options to get it sorted out. Okay, this is regarding rescission of a contract, contractual law. Okay, Indian Contract Act. So, a person who wrongfully rescinds a contract is entitled to compensation for any damage which he has sustained through the non-fulfillment of the contract. Is that true? No. A person who rightfully rescinds a contract is not entitled to compensation for any damage which he has sustained through the non-fulfillment of the contract. No. Remember, should be correct. A person who rightfully rescinds a contract is entitled to compensation for any damage which he has sustained through the non-fulfillment of the contract? Yes. Okay. And the last option will be no. So this is the option C is the right answer. Now the 22nd question. Every person is competent to contract. So you, in this case, you should know, be familiar with essentials of a contract. Okay. There are about 10 essentials from competency to contract. Offer and acceptance. Consideration. Lawful object, okay, all these should be satisfied. So every person is competent to contract. So who are the people who are incompetent? They are minors, insane people, and those or intoxicated people, and those people who are disqualified from the law. So this person who is competent to contract is who is of the age of majority according to law. To which he is subject. Subject means he is a citizen and who is of sound mind and is not disqualified from contracting by any law to which he is being subjected to. So this option is the right one. Option D. Kindly be familiar with the essentials of a contract. The 22nd question we dealt with. Now coming on to the 23rd question. If A leaves his car with the driver's position will be, so you should be familiar with mediate and immediate position. They are kinds of position, okay? It comes under jurisprudence. Kindly refer to the subtopic. In fact, if you join on Plus, I have taken class on this. So please make sure you use my code Cyril Life, so you will be having access to all my classes. Okay. Option A is the right answer, immediate, whereas that of party A would be mediate. Then 24th question, which of the following statement is correct? Is A, B, C or D? The right answer is option C, the fundamental duties have been added through an amendment. Okay. They have not always been a part of the constitution. They are mandatory on all the persons. Cannot be the most suitable option is option C. Kindly note Article 51A deal with fundamental duties as per Indian Constitution. So make sure you are able to read the question properly and answer. Now 25th question. Once again, we have law of dots. Which of the following statement is true? It can be statement or S. Statements, one or more. So in tot, duty is imposed by law and is owed to the community at large. Only this statement is true. Rest all are false. A tort is not founded upon the consent of parties, okay? And common law action cannot be generated. In tort, motive for the violation is immaterial, that and all is false statement. Only one statement is true, that is option one. Only A is correct. Now, 26th question. Consideration is the recompense, okay, given by the party contracting to the other. Who said this? When you hear the word consideration in terms of contract, you should remember the Latin maxim quid pro quo. Something in exchange or return. Example, money. This is the most common form of consideration. The above definition is attributed to, is it sorry about this? It's about, it's A, B, C and D. The right option is Blackstone. Blackstone said that consideration is the recompense given by the party contracting to each other. Hope you follow. Now you need to once again know the Hindu Marriage Act. Hindu Marriage Act. So Hindu contracting a second marriage during pendency of appeal against a decree of divorce will be void. Okay. It will not be valid, invalid or factum void. It will be clearly void. All right. The 28th question. In the absence of any evidence as to mens rea, so this question you need to be knowing the principles of criminal liability, mens rea and actus reus. In fact, I have already taken a class on YouTube for this. Please make sure you watch that video. Subscribe to the Unacademy channel on YouTube. So which of these cases criminal liability can be fixed upon a person with regarding to absence of evidence as to the mens rea? So is it option A, where the consequences are not so harmful to the society? Option B, where there is no violent presumption? Or option C, the intended consequence is not injurious on other facts, or option D, when an act is not performed wantonly, it is option C. The intended consequence is not injurious on any other facts. Now, question number 29. Which of the following are an exception to the rule of strict liability? So you should know exceptions in tort. Especially liabilities is an important topic. Is it defendant's own fault, statutory authority, consent of third parties, or act of defendant? It is clearly option B, statutory authority, that is an exception to the rule of strict liability. Question number 30. Which of the following is correct? DPSP, that is directive principles of state policy, are part and parcel of fundable rights? No. It is part 4. Not part 3. Part 3 is fundamental rights. Okay. Directive principle of state policy override fundamental rights? No. Fundamental rights override directive principle of state policy? Yes. Okay. So it's not A, B, or D. It's option C that is the right answer. Now, you should know what vicarious liability means. It means master's liability for the wrong of the servant. He's responsible. He should be responsible. Responde superior. It is not liability without fault. Servant's liability for the wrong of the master or damage which cannot be prevented. That will be based on contingent events. So the next question you should all know, dear friends. Right to education is guaranteed under Article 21A of Indian Constitution. It is not 21, 2022, it's 21A. So you should be familiar with the maxim of actus reus. Actus non facit riem nisi mensit ria, it literally means prohibited act followed by guilty intention constitutes an offense. It is not any of the remaining options. Option D is the right answer. But in the 33rd question we discussed today. Now, international law, you should know the definition. Okay. It is not a collection of legislations of various countries. It is not collection of customs of various countries. It is not a legal instrument. Rather, it is a body of rules and principles of actions that are binding upon civilized states. State is nation, is equal to nation, in relation with each other. So the right option is option B. So we'll tick that. Then, pertaining to Article 23, Clause 1 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. You should be familiar with the human rights. You have it as an important subtopic. Please be familiar with it. So, which is corresponding with one of the articles of the Constitution? Which article in the Indian Constitution corresponds with Article 23, Clause 1 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights? The right answer is Article 41 and not 39, 43, or 38. Right option is Article 41. The 36th question. A has a house and nobody should interfere with the enjoyment of proprietary right over the house. So this right is called, is it option A, personal right, option B, right imperfect right, option C, right in rem, and option D, right in personam. So you should know the different types of rights. This again comes in jurisprudence. Okay, right in REM is the right answer. Okay, option C. Then question number 37, adverse possession. So you should be familiar with, again, possession of property may lead to loss of, that means adverse possession means negative possession may lead to loss of what? Is it possession, normal possession, ownership or liberty? The right answer will be power and not the remaining. It will lead to or result in, you should know the consequences of adverse possession. It will lead to loss of power. So 37 questions discussed, dear friends. 38, we are coming to the last few questions. 38th one is, the Supreme Court is a court of records. Yes, that is a very true statement. You should know why it is a court of records, because it has the powers of a court to punish for contempt of itself. Okay, that is why Supreme Court is called a court of record. It has the powers to punish for contempt itself. It is the highest court of appeal. That's what court of record means, not the remaining options. That is, its judgments are binding on all courts. It has got powers to pass orders for enforcement of its own judgments, full faith and credit. The most suitable option here pertaining to court of record is, it has the powers of a court to punish for contempt itself. So offer must be specific. This is again contractual law, not general, incapable of communication, possible. This is very terms should be specified clearly and not vaguely. Okay. Dear friends, we have come to the end of the class. Focus on kindly make sure you are able to focus on few aspects. Okay, sorry about this, the pen just got weird. Assertioning and reasoning questions. Statements by jurists and judges. Important cases, especially with regard to Constitution of India. Then legal maxims, this is very important for your NET exam. Repeated questions are asked. Then remaining contractual law provisions, and provisions are important, that is sections are important of all the particular, of any particular subtopic that you take. So kindly make sure you focus on all these aspects. that is assertioning and reasoning, that is legal aptitude, statements by jurists and judges, important cases, legal maxims and provisions. Once again, let me reiterate on the benefits of Plus. Use my code to subscribe. It's very affordable. Rate is 6 months. Please take it. Use my code and immediately get a 10% off. Cyril Live, CYRILLIVE. Get the subscription today. Currently, like I mentioned, I'm teaching Constitutional Law Unit 2 and Administrative Law, but that doesn't mean you don't have access to, once you subscribe, you'll have access to all the content. Okay. And benefits of Unacademy Plus, like I told you, live structured courses, interactive sessions, doubt clearing sessions, unlimited access to the educator's content, weekly quiz, mega quiz. We have download, you can download the PDFs. Okay. The benefit is that you can, with educators writing or without annotations, with or without annotations, you can choose to. So kindly follow me on Unacademy. Again, we discuss about 40 questions from International Code of Justice, International Law, Consumer Protection Act. We handle constitutional law, jurisprudence, company law, UDHR, that is the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, treaties, asylum. We handle family law. We talked about Muslim law, law of torts, principal organs, public international law. Principal organs of UN is very important. And we talked about natural justice and administrative action. Jurisprudence is a very important topic difference. Please make sure you do not skip the studying it. Essentials of a contract. Okay. And you should know that parties who are competent should be a major, sound mind, and not disqualified by the law to which he is subject, like we answered in the option. Then about possession, the fundamental duties, Article 51A of the Indian Constitution. We talked about consideration, the Latin maxim associated with it. Mens rea, actus reus, principles of criminal liability. Once again, part 3, part 4, directive principle of state policy and fundamental rights was discussed, UDHR and relation to constitution. Indian constitution. Definition of international law, different rights. All these are associated with jurisprudence. Then contractual laws are really important difference. Please make sure you take time out to focus on it. Kindly subscribe so you will have access to all the content. Once again, key areas of focus I've highlighted. So all the best difference. Wishing you all the best. Kindly make sure you hit a like on this video if you enjoyed the session, right? So have a very good day, and I will see you on the 29th. Okay. On, sorry, not 29th, on 30th. January at 10 a.m. I have a class on YouTube. Do attend and all the best. Thank you, Cyril Jacob, signing off.